Hello and welcome to another episode of Face to Face. My name is Godfred Akoto Boafo. My guest today has gone through an interesting evolution. Footballer, national team captain, coach, philanthropist, and I guess now we can add author because he has written a book. Former captain of the national team and former head coach of the Black Stars, James Kwesi Appiah, is our guest on Face to Face. Hello, coach. Welcome to Face to Face.
Yeah, it's a pleasure.
It's an interesting evolution. Did you think that we'll be sitting here today not discussing football, but discussing a book that you have written?
Yeah, I never thought of it. But, you know, in life, as you grow, you think of other things that maybe you need to do. And I think it's important we leave something behind for our young ones who are coming up.
So at what point did it hit you that I need to tell my story to Ghanaians? You've been in the public domain since the 80s. People know you, but then again, you'd say people don't really know you as well. So at what point did you decide that, let me put myself out there and tell my story my own way?
Yeah, in actual fact, I read a story on Aswinga and then Alex Ferguson. And that actually inspired because I learned a lot of things in it, which I added to what I knew. And after some time, I thought about it and I said, why is it that the white men are always writing something for us Ghanaians to read? And I believe that, every Ghanaian, people talk about Ghanaians don't like reading or Africans don't like reading. I believe that if we Africans start writing things about ourselves, people will get more interested in it, you know. But the more they read, they know this thing is here, I'm reading about it. This thing happened that year, I'm reading about that. That stories has been always about what happened, you know, in other countries. So I thought to myself, there's been a lot of big coaches, big players around. Unfortunately, many of them are dying. Many of them could not actually have the opportunity to write something down for us to, you know, get something out of it. So I thought to myself, I need to put something down so that the younger ones can at least learn something from my playing days, learn something from my coaching days as well.
And you decided to call it Leaders Don't Have to Yell. And I guess the title is an attribute to your demeanor. You've never been one for many words and never been one to be aggressive on the outside.
In actual fact, my lifestyle, as you said, says more about the title of the book. I believe that even here, where, let's say, you are the boss, if they come around and you are always shouting at them or yelling at them, I don't believe that you get the results that you need. It's important you humble yourself, show them the respect needed, but where needed, once in a while, you know, there are some people who doesn't like being shouted at, especially, you know, when they are around their colleagues. You know, sometimes you need to find means to get to, you know. And when it comes to coaching itself, I believe that it's not the shouting or throwing of legs and hands on the touchline that makes the difference. It's important you send the messages across to the players at the right time. In actual fact, you can only send messages to the players whenever there is an infringement, you know. The game comes to a standstill. Because that's the only time any player on the pitch will turn and maybe look at the coach and listen to whatever he's saying. You know, but as to the emotions that people, it depends on everyone, how he reacts to his emotions. You know, that does not mean his emotions are having any effect on the players. If that is the case, then Simone of Atletico Madrid, you have won all the leagues because he done a lot of running and shouting and throwing of hands. So most of the time, it's important to be as a coach, you know when to send messages across. And as I said, it's only when the game comes to a standstill or at halftime, that's where you can give important messages to them.
You say a lot in the book, and I was captured by the first chapter of the book where you talk about being from a boy to a man. If your father were here today, what would he say? Considering that in the book you say you came back from a game one day with an injury and he was like, "Banka, banka."
Yeah, you know, my father never wanted me to play. As a young guy, he wanted me either to be a doctor or lawyer or accountant. Mm-hmm. But in school, because I was really good in accounting, he thought I could pursue my accounting course. And then when he realized that my interest is going into football, it was a time he actually never wanted to talk to me because I didn't do what he wanted me to. And but when I got to Kotoko, mm-hmm. that was where his interest came back.
Was he a Kotoko fan?
He wasn't a Kotoko fan, but he was. He thought that he's pure Ashanti, mm-hmm. and he thought that once you play in Kotoko, you are like the son of Otunfo. Yeah. So he got to a time where, I think it's in the book, where when I became the captain of the team, Kotoko, he said to me, "As captain of Kotoko, why don't you go to Otunfo every morning to greet him or have chats with him?" And I said to myself, "What is he talking about?" Because I knew, if you are captain, that does not mean you should always be going to Otunfo. So I intentionally told him, "Oh, I don't have any dress that I can put on." So he was then working in Accra. He came to Accra, and when he was coming back to Kumasi, he bought, those days they had this political suit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So he bought four of them. He said, "When you take this today, tomorrow you take this one too." So it was fun, but it's later he got to know that it's something that I wanted to do.
You have other father figures in your career, and I realize that in your dedications, you mentioned Coach Ike Afrani, late Coach Ike Afrani. That is not a small honor to give. When you write a book and you dedicate it to people and Coach Ike Afrani is in there, what did he mean to you?
No, I think he played a big role in my football career. When we came to play the Middle League, actually that was where I was selected to the Black Meteors. Mm-hmm. And at that particular time, he chose some of us in the Black Meteors team and took all of us to PCA Masters. So he encouraged me to stay there. He encouraged me to, get active, very active in it. And he said that since I've been invited to the Black Meteors team, it's easier, going from there to the national team. Mm-hmm. And truly, after a year, with PCA Masters, I went straight to the Blasters. Mm-hmm. So I think he did a lot of things. And fortunately, when I got to the Blasters, he was also part of the technical mm-hmm. team, because by then, CK Jamfi, Osam Dudu, and Afrani, they were handling the national team.
Kotoko also seems to play a significant role. They are given quite a considerable amount of ink in this book. Your Kotoko chapter, how did that shape the man and coach that you were to become?
After 1981, when I went to Blasters, that was where Blasters, those days, Kotoko had about 14, 15 players in camp.
Mm.
So that was where Bukunti and Papakon, they chartered me, to come to Kotoko. But when I came, it was like, I stayed in Kotoko for about 13 years as a player. And then that was where I also started my coaching career. I coached up to 1995, 96 season, as the head coach. And then I continued, went outside, came back in 2000. That was where John Satikofio was in charge. I was then his assistant. You know, so I went back and then came back 2008. You know, so that was how come I spoke a lot about Kotoko, because I spent most of my time as a player and then as a coach.
And also, you talk about managing disputes and the leadership skills that you learned. And again, Kumasi Asante Kotoko is the place where you mastered this particular art as a captain and as a leader. How did that prepare you for what was to lie ahead?
I think 1984, that was when I was made assistant captain of the team, you know. And then 1988, you know, I became the captain of the team. And so right from onset, since I was then the captain of the Black Meteors team, that leadership qualities, you know, started from there. And then with Kotoko, because of the assistant captain's role, the head, the captain's role, I thought I started learning about how to, you know, cool tempers down, because sometimes players get very angry. And you as the captain, you need to stand in as the coach and try to calm tempers down or try to talk to individuals. There were situations where, even as the captain, I used my own money, give to some player, key players, who actually needed money to play, you know, to let them perform very well. So I tried making sure every player was happy, you know, every player's mindset should be, I'm out there to kill myself for the coach.
Interesting. Now, when all this had happened, eventually you got linked with the national team via John Satikofio, like you had said. What was the national team like from the technical bench at that period? That was different from what you had experienced as a national team player.
Actually, because I had I've been assistant coach with Malik Javier at Kotoko. He went away, and there's another coach called Watara. He came in, I was an assistant to him, and then Buka Caesar, he also came in. Before I was made the head coach, 95-96 season. So when I came to the Blasters, I had, you know, ideas on how to manage players. But, you know, talking of the Blasters, it's a different ball game, you know, because these players are big players, you know, with some of them with some egos. So you need to try and treat them in a way that will make them happy to play for you. And I think being assistant to Jones, I learned a little bit, and then I went away. Came to be assistant with Claude Roy. He went away, and then Milovan. He also went, and then Stevanovic, and then I took over. So before I took over, I learned a lot of lessons from all these coaches.
And you also describe an interesting dynamic in getting a foot through the front door. You paint the picture of a man who was determined to get an opportunity, but found impediments in his way, but still also found ways around that impediment. You talk about you sending in an application, you talk about calling President Kufuor to find out if he could help you. Can you talk a bit about making a headway around the system at that time?
Yeah, I was then in UK, so I heard that the national team, because they had then finished the Cup of Nations, and I think during the Cup of Nations, Claude Roy and Celestete was there. So the assistant coach position became vacant. So there was sort of people should apply. So I heard about it, I applied, and I knew that there's no one in this world who will say, oh, I got to any job that I did not go through anybody. Mm-hmm. You know, because at the end of the day, when I spoke to President Akoto Boafo, he said, oh, okay, Kwesi, I've heard, but it's important you send your CV to them. Mm-hmm. If they are interested in you, then you come back to me. So I sent the application, and they actually called me for an interview. And then after, I decided to call, okay, I've sent my application. They've called me for an interview. And looking at things, I think from the way they said it, my CV looks, you know, somehow better. You know, so at that end, you know, if he could do something or he has to do something, and he said, oh, as an assistant coach, it's something that you come in to learn, so it shouldn't be a problem. And you know something, when I came, at that time, Corey Roy was earning, I think around $30,000. Mm. And that time, they were giving me $3,000.
So I really? Went to him.
Yeah. I went to him and I said, listen, yeah, give me only $3,000. But the white man, he said, Kwesi, don't ever complain about money being given to you now. One day, you will also go to where he is and end that. So if even they are giving you $1,000, take the $1,000 and keep quiet and learn something. And that's something that I will never forget. And I appreciate that fact, you know, because I believe that it's better you learn, make sure you are 100% prepared, you know, before you step into any, you know, shape. So that's about it.
I found another interesting line in the book when you spoke about your relationship with Milovan Milo Rahivac when he was appointed. This is somebody you did not share a language with, but you somehow created a bond, a professional bond, that was quite successful. Mm-hmm. How did you do that?
Milo was a really nice guy. When he came, he said, oh, he asked about me. I told him, I've got 3 girls. And when I was playing, I used to play left back. So he started laughing. I said, ah, why are you laughing? So I see he didn't understand the English, but he spoke through his interpreter. Mm-hmm. And then the interpreter told me, because he has also got 3 girls, and he also used to play left back. So since then, there was kind of big love between us. And I got to a stage where his trust and belief in me was really, really high. He told me to leave my house, come and live with him. And there was nothing he did without consulting me. Mm. Even along the line, he got to a stage, said, Kwesi, Kapi, he used to call me Kapi. Kapi, you do the team, prepare the team, and then you bring. To me, when I prepare the team and I send it to him, okay, Kapi, why you put this one, not this one? I said, oh, because this. He said, okay. This one starts, no good, this one come. So the latter days of his career, he allowed me.
And you were basically coaching the team?
No, he gave me opportunity to learn. I saw it as a learning process. You know, there are some people, when you're working with them, they don't allow you to take any decision. But I believe that it's important, anyone under you, you allow him, you know, to do some things so that you see whether he's learning or he's preparing himself for the job ahead of him.
The World Cup in 2010, obviously a high point in your professional career. What was so different about the World Cup? Why were we so good at that World Cup?
You see, we were really good at that World Cup 2010 because we were fortunate to have players. We did under the five-year development plan that Ben Kofi had done. Mm-hmm. And I think that actually helped Ghana a lot. Look at this setup where this same team went to the 206, and then they stayed another 4 years, you know, being matured and confidently, you know, being so confident, you know. So this same team we brought them to the 2010. So for me, the preparation had been done. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that process, we carried on. We didn't destroy it. You know, but the major problem, or what we as all Ghanaians did not do, was what is the succession plan? Mm-hmm. You know, we were just concentrating on these same guys. Even I remember any time you call a team and you leave one of them out, there's a big problem on you as a coach. You know, but we did not prepare. We relied totally on them, you know, and then that's why we are all suffering now.
Conversation with James Kwesi Appiah discussing his new book, Leaders Don't Have to Yell, National Team Coaching, National Team Coach on Leading High Performing Teams. When we return, we'll talk about his time in full charge of the Black Stars and also what lessons there are in reading his new book. Face to Face, we'll be right back. Welcome back to Face to Face with James Kwesi Appiah, former coach of the Black Stars. We're basically having a quiet chat about his new book. Lots of interesting revelations in there. And coach, you had been given the team. Now, did you always want the job on a full-time basis? You had served under so many people. Was it always at the back of your mind that I want to take this team and build it in my own image with my own philosophy?
Yeah, I'm 100% sure. No one works and thinks that, you know, he stay wherever he is. Everyone works with the ambition that one day, you know, I'll be the head. And I thought that after going learning through so many coaches, you know, I had the experience, you know, to put it out there. What I wanted to see is a Ghana team, you know, with the head coach as Ghanaian. You know, it's something that I thought is important for us Ghanaians, you know. And I was really happy when given the opportunity.
What was your vision? What did you think would be your legacy by the time your coaching career with the national team ended, on that day when you were told the Black Stars is yours, take it?
Yeah, in actual fact, I realized we've done a lot of mistakes not preparing a succession plan for the national team, you know, and that is where I thought to myself, if you realize, since I came, I've always been introducing a lot of players, giving other players opportunity, so that all we all Ghanaians can choose the best amongst them, you know, to play for us. People did not understand me. They thought I'm calling a lot of players. But the bottom line is, we didn't have a standing team like ACN's time. ACN, Sule, Jan. See, the team was there. So any coach who came over, it was much, much easier for you, because the team has been prepared. Now, I took over at a time where these players were, you know, getting old or you know, going off the scene. So in that aspect, what do you do? We had not done anything like that, any plan for some players to take over. So I had to take the risk, you know, in trying to bring a lot of players, because you see, bringing a lot of players in as a coach is risk taking. I'm putting my job on the line. Meanwhile, if we had done a succession plan, the setup would have been there. Then you work with them, and then you add maybe one or two players, you know, then you carry on with it. But it's not being my during my situation, I didn't have the opportunity, you know. So it's important that we make sure, even now, if we're preparing the team now, we make sure we have a backup team. And if you realize who else in charge, I didn't make sure I have a team, but I was trying to encourage some other young guys so that in case these guys move out, we have these guys who've been prepared there, you know, to take over easily.
I always find some of your additions interesting. I remember you brought a young chap called Christian Achu.
Yeah.
At that time. Where did you find him? How did you convince yourself that this was the right time to unleash him? Because I recall it was a game against either Ethiopia or Malawi at the Baba Yara Stadium.
Yeah.
Ghana won 5-0. and he absolutely ripped everybody apart that day.
You see, personally, what I've been doing is, if I come to you and you tell me, oh, there's a player here issue, maybe you think, oh, I've just told him, he will not take it. Maybe I leave, you know, just send it straight. I have a data that I do put on, and then I'll check his last five games that he's played, because we have a software that can check all his games. I do that, and then I check whether he's that good, as you're saying. And for instance, it was my brother-in-law who said, oh, there's a player here, you know, he's doing very well. He thinks I should have a look at him. So I checked on him. I said, okay, let me give him opportunity. You know, and that is something that I think most coaches don't do, giving people opportunity to prove themselves. You know, but I believe that as a country, this is not a club. As a country, we should have, you know, about three set of teams. We should not rely on only one team. You know, once you rely on a team, then if we even, for instance, our game against South Africa, I heard about Harrison was injured, Wakasu was injured, Luma was injured. We had about four of them being injured. And at that particular time, what do? Do you have to go and bring? And I took the risk, brought I think eight debutants, you know, to be in the team. Even I had a bashing, the management could not understand why, playing against South Africa, I've brought on young guys. And I said to him, look, I have 100% believe these young guys are the future of our country. I believe that they can play the game for us. Even if we lose against South Africa and you sack me, I will love it more. But I believe that even if I'm sacked, these guys will one day I'll be old with my cloth, and then I'll be watching the same guys who play. And truly, after the game, you know, they came hugging me, saying, oh, the guys have proved them wrong. You know, but it's something we need to, it's difficult. Even many people come, oh, why are you always changing the team? But it's good to have at least two set of players who are really competent, who are really competitive. In other way, it helps players not feeling like, oh, whenever I come, I will play. No, when they know that there are other players who are competing with them, the other players, when they are injured or they don't perform well, these young guys will take over from them, then they will sit up.
You spoke about the 2014 World Cup experience. It was disappointing for you.
Yeah, actually. But you see,
it was supposed to be the high point for you.
In natural fact, yes, because at that time I thought we had a lot of very good players, you know, for the competition. But you see, I always keep saying that every success, you need other factors, you know, to make sure you'll be successful, or there will be success at the end. You know, so when some areas are not performed at the best that should be, then automatically, you know, there will be issues. And you see, when it comes to football, players don't joke with even one penny. If you have to give them one penny, you give them one penny.
But should it be about money? People say a national team is played for love. You played the national team for love.
But you see, that is why most my playmates, those who won the last cup that Ghana won, 1982, some of them are begging now. You see, we are not looking. Every footballer, your lifespan in the game is about 10 years. And these 10 years is where every money that you deserve, you should get it. But it's how you use it is another thing. But you see, if a player is playing now and whatever he needs to get, he doesn't get it. Look at Jerry Akaminko. He were going to the World Cup. He got injured and nobody cares about him now. Do we know where he is now? So in the book, I've said that, look, I'm advising the players as well, because I said any money that you get, you need to invest and make sure by the time you stop playing, if you are even playing for 1 year, if you're living 1 year, you make sure you have something that you can rely on. Because you see, football is a profession that you go in, you don't learn any tailoring job, you don't learn any carpentry job. All you know is the football. So once you go off the game, it becomes a burden. And many of my players are suffering now. Do we all want to see the players, our old players, suffering the way they are now? No. So I believe that anything that they deserve, and this money that we're talking about, in the first place, it wasn't money that was coming from Ghana. That was being paid by the government. It was money that is being assigned to us every
participating country.
Yes. And this money is being paid from FIFA. I think that 2010, 2014, I know we earned 8-point-something million. So is that 8-point-something million that the players are deserving some percentage of it? And in the first place, 2006 was paid, 2010 was paid before the tournament. So why the delay in the payment for 2014? And you see, it caused a lot of issues with players agitating, fighting, and all sort of things. And that's why I'm trying to say, in every good management or in every setup, if you want success, you make sure the management, the playing, the technical team, the playing body, everyone's mind should be tuned. There should no disturbances along the line.
So you're saying that when we arrived in Marseille to prepare for that World Cup, the team was not as focused as you would have wanted the team playing in the World Cup to be?
Yeah, automatically, because it started in Holland. Mm. Holland, the players had a meeting with the management requesting for the money. The money was not given. They said, oh, when you get to the U.S.? The players got to the U.S., the money was not given. They had another meeting with the minister and everybody. They said, by the time you arrive in
Marseille, Brazil,
the money will be there. And it never... And you see, even before our game with
USA.
So the players were like, why are we being treated like kids? In actual fact, these players, they think that once you respect them, they also pay back or reciprocate. So you don't look down on them and think that, they are kids, or you can just say anything you want to tell them, and then the next day you say another thing. So that is something that happened, day after day after day. And it wasn't something that, and you see, it got to a stage where even players didn't say, no, coach, you've said enough. Always we have looked at you, to keep calm. But now it's becoming too much. We need to put our foot down. And that's how come they say, okay, we're not training. Or that was before the Portugal game.
Yes.
So you ask yourself, then even if the Portugal game, I think that things have been done earlier. And going into that game, they are all focused and psychologically prepared for the game. Automatically, we would have earned something. But a team cannot go on or be successful when there are issues to be solved.
When you look back at the incidents that covered that World Cup, do you take any form of responsibility for what happened there? Would you have done anything different sitting here today?
I mean, all I could do is to request and make sure. I mean, I can't say I should even make sure, because I'm not the one who's going to pay them. I'll have done my best. No, even that, we all had a series of meeting with the management, making sure, look, why can't... And you see, the stories were coming from the top over, it's coming today, tomorrow. And sometimes when something gets to a certain level, if you, the coach, you want respect from the players, there are sometimes you need to stay back, or you can't, there's something...
Especially at that level.
Yeah, you can't. Well, the thing is, I'm not the one who is paying it, or the one who is going to instruct anybody to bring the payment. So if you step in and you also try to lie in front of them, then you're going to lose your respect, and it becomes difficult for you.
What was the biggest takeaway from that particular World Cup for you going forward as a coach? Because you didn't quit coaching. You went on. You went to coach in Sudan and the rest. Yeah. What was the biggest lesson for you?
No, I think that at that particular time, as a coach, you always bear anything, any responsibility, or if someone doesn't do his work well, all comes to you, you know, back to you as the manager, all the blames and everything. You accept that, but for me, it makes me more stronger. It makes me more stronger, but I learn from, you know, the mistakes that, you know, were being done in the tournament.
You left and everybody thought, it's over for Kwesi Appiah. Kwesi Appiah showed up in Sudan. Was that somewhere you had envisioned coaching Sudan?
No, actually. You see, this was even a club side.
Yeah.
But they came out with an offer that was difficult to refuse. You know, because here in Ghana, I was being paid, I think, 20,000. Mm-hmm. I went there, and it was, even though it's a club side, I was being paid 40,000. So I thought that, and they actually had a project. They thought that we should build a team. Mm-hmm. You know, we should build a team. And which actually, when I went there, fortunately, the young guys that I picked from there under 20, I brought them to the senior team. And as we speak, initially before I left there, 9 of my players were in the national team. But as of now, 6 of the young guys that I brought in are playing their national team. I think that it wasn't a planned thing to go to Sudan, but wherever you find yourself as a coach, the most important thing, you try to do the best that you can. You may not be the best, but do the best that you can, and then you leave a mark, and you move on.
You came back to coach the Black Stars. Was there a part of you that said, maybe I should not take this job, things have not changed?
No, I thought that Ghana needs to build a team. You see, we have always lived with this idea, oh, Ghana, you know, we will win. Or some teams are easy, we take. You see, football has gone to a level where you can never underrate any team in this world now. And for that reason, we relied on, as I said, the names that we used to know. And those days, many of the countries had not developed up to this level. So we were winning most of our games. Now all these players that we relied on, they are all out of the scene. Now, if our thinking, let's still bring these old ones that we know, then where are we going? No, but it takes someone, you know, who, I don't know how to put it, risk-free, or I'm the kind of coach who will always take risk with what I do. You know, because in coaching, every decision that you take is risk-taking. But the important thing is, what did you learn from it? You know, if you take the risk and you achieve something from it, fine. If you take the risk and it doesn't work, you learn from it and you carry on. You see, take for instance, you are with is it Medeama?
No, Liberty.
Liberty.
Yes.
And there are some positions that you may find some key players competing at that position. So you might choose one of them to play, let's say, against Kotoko on Sunday. If the one that you chose flops in that game, or through him, you know, a goal is scored against you, automatically you would ask, why didn't I use this guy? So every selection or every decision that you take along the line, you know, is taking the risk. And that's why every coach, when you're coaching, you put your bag, should be behind you. So immediately, you know, you lose a game or they say they are sacking you, you take your bag and you carry on. You know, the most important thing is every time you need to learn something, every decision that you take, learn something from it.
You've been to a lot of AFCONs as head coach, as an assistant.
Mm-hmm.
2018 in Egypt. Mm-hmm.
2019
in Egypt. What was the agenda going in? Obviously, it was to win, but the build-up to it, was everything as you wanted it to be going there?
No, I believe that, you know, the management did their part, you know. And as I said, the management has to do their role. The technical team has to also think of what they need to do to bring out results. Then the playing body. But you see, sometimes we need to be frank to ourselves and say, ask ourselves, are we sure we can just walk? You see, there's no competition that we can just walk in and think that, oh, I will go. But before every, I don't believe that any team that came to the AFCON said, oh, we are just coming to play the AFCON and go back. Every coach or every country's ambition or vision is to win the cup. We actually did the best that we can, because I look at my players and I think many of them, you know, needed some kind of exposure and experience where we can all say, oh, now they are all at the top level. You know, when I say at the top level, you even ask ourselves, how many of our players are playing at the highest level? You know, look at ECN's time, where I'm talking about John Mercer, John Pinsel, all of them were playing at the highest level. So it becomes easier for any coach. But in this particular one, we told her, look, many of our guys are not playing at the highest level. Many of our guys have not even played together as a team. And it's important, we'll go out there with ambition to win the cup, but we should not think that it's going to be easy. And I believe that we, during the first eliminations, we did the best, we topped the group, you know, went to the next stage. And it's not like we were beaten, we were actually out on penalties. And for me, I don't see it as a loss or as something that you did not do well. Penalties, you could be the best team in the world. When it gets to penalties, you can just be out of the competition. But the bottom line is, let's look at Senegal, for instance. This is a team that the coach has been given a plan. You know, they've worked up to a level where all the players are now playing at the highest level. So in that aspect, you go out there and you think, look, this is a team. This team has played together. This team has, all the players are playing at the highest level. So for that reason, we should be no excuses. You need to go out there and win the cup. But you see, as I said, football is a game that even sometimes you can have all the chances in the world. If it's not your day or things don't go well, you know, you might miss out along the line.
All right, then. James, Kwesi Appiah is on Face to Face. We'll take our final break. He has his best 11 in this book. And some of the names there, you know, some of you might ask, what? We'll discuss this when Face to Face returns. Welcome back to Face to Face. We're doing a sort of review of Coach James Kwesi Appiah's new book, Leaders Don't Have to Yell. And from the conversation, I'm sure you know you have to go get your own copy. I have mine in front of me. And I'm looking at the last chapter. When you do get it, chapter 19, Coach has listed his best 11, Ghana. He has a reserve team, and then he has honorable mentions. So, Coach, let's talk about some of the names in here. This list is controversial in my estimation, but since it's your squad, I'll let it be. So you have Richard Kinson in goal, Ernest Appel. He's a player from your generation. Why does he make this list ahead of other players that you have coached and played with?
Yeah, actually, I was looking at players that I've known, you know, during my playing days and then my coaching career. No, so that's how come I added Ernest Appel to the list.
Yeah, you played with him at Kotoko.
Yeah, he played a right fullback during when we won the cup in 1983.
Okay,
he's very athletic, very hardworking, and during our days we were the two guys that started overlapping runs. You know, and he always did it very perfect.
I'm not surprised to see Ofe Ansa, because I've heard of him. But for a Kotoko man to put a Haas man in his best 11, he must have been really that good.
Yeah, Ofe was really good. The good thing is he could play the left back or the right back. And it was really difficult to beat him. And his tackles, you know, so it was always... attackers never wanted to face him.
Oh, okay.
He's a strong guy who I thought should deserves to be
to be in your squad. Okay. Then you have Samuel Osei Okufo and John Mensah forming the centre-back partnership. No shock there. Then you have Kotoko's midfield maestro, Papa Akun, in there as well. For those who didn't watch him, what kind of player was he?
He was a defensive midfielder. He was really good with both legs. If he's playing with the left, he thinks he's a left footer. If he's playing with the right, he thinks he's a right footer. And he was a kind of defensive midfielder who always wants to attack with the ball. You know, he will dribble through whenever the opportunity comes. And whenever he's finished his job, he comes back, you know, to defend. And he talks a lot to control, you know, because he was a captain, he controls, made sure everything was going on the pitch.
Okay. Then he continues with Michael Essien, partnering Papa Akun. There is Stephen Appiah, no shock there. Asamoajan is in there. Abedi Pele is here again, no shock there. A lot has been said about your relationship with Abedi Pele, and I think on several times you've had to come out and say, "Look, we are fine."
Yeah, I'm actually surprised why. I don't blame the people with the situation, but I think at that particular time the management did not do well. They came out to tell the public that we're going to Senegal. And because Senegal is a French-speaking country, you know, the captaincy was being taken from me to Abedi. So I thought that it's the management who didn't present the thing very well. If they had asked me before the presentation, I would have told them, look, I've been captain for 4 years because I captained from 88 to 92. So you push me to general captain and make him the captain. But if they didn't do that, and people have that
mindset about it.
Yeah, that because after a couple of nations, as we sit here now, I'm not 100% sure, but it should be between 7 to 9 times I've been to his house.
Oh.
And we sit down and we drink.
And have conversations. And then Samuel Opokunti also comes here. A lot of the green turf.
Yeah. He was very good, and most of the time, he made sure once he's on the pitch, he wants to win. You know, he's a guy, if you play even a mistake at the back there, he'll come and fight with you. You know?
All right. Now, coach mentions his reserve players, Sule Muntari, Anthony Yeboah is on your bench. Mm. That's a strong bench.
Yeah.
Harrison Afo is also there. Talk to me about Harrison. A lot of contemporary Ghanaians consider him one of the most intelligent players they have seen. Somebody who can play the 2, can play the 10, can play the 7. Mm. Talk to us a bit about Harrison.
No, Harrison is tactically very, very disciplined. And when it comes to technique, I think he's one of the best that we have in our team. And as you said, he's a player that you can play different positions. Anywhere you shift him, he will adapt himself and play. Just that, you know, at the position like left back or the right back, looking at the height, it's not the best, but because of his intelligence. Mm-hmm. And more nowadays, even if you're playing 3 back, it's a matter of pushing him up front, and he will do a lot of very good runs for you.
Okay. And then your good friend Frimpong Manso is also on the bench. Sam Ampe is on the bench as well. So that makes up the reserves. And then we have the honorable mentions. Now, this is because he's making a 23-man squad.
Yeah.
So we are going for a tournament. So he has honorable mentions. So we have Nketiah Yorson, who played for Accra, Hassel Folk, a swag player of the year 1979. Kofi Bedu is also honorably mentioned. Kwejo Asamoa, he was one player a lot of people thought he would be able to get back into the national team. He went out. What was wrong with him?
Kwejo actually had a lot of issues. Even though he's one guy who wants to serve his nation, wants to do the best that he can for his nation, but he had an injury. And the injury, it got to a level where they were supposed to take every time, even as at now, from my understanding, anytime he needs to get on the pitch, there's an injection that he needs to take, you know. And then, actually,
it just wasn't right
not,
for him.
Yeah, it's not good for him, but at the end of the day, he doesn't want to be seen to, like, oh, I've ignored the national team. No, he thought he could do both ways. But saying that anytime you call him, you know, he comes and he gives us his values. But you see, most of the time, the game is developing so fast. And that's why I said there are so many players that you need to compete with. Names that don't play football nowadays, it's important if you want a successful team, make sure, you know, you put out, whether he's young or he's old, it's what he can bring on board on the pitch is what matters.
Okay, I have just two more questions for you. So you've done a launch of the book in all the three places that matter to you. Mm-hmm. You are an Asante man who was born in the Bono Afro region. So you've done a Sunyani launch. Mm-hmm. You've done a Kumasi and then Accra. Mm-hmm. Why Accra?
No, as you said, I was born in Sunyani. Mm-hmm. And that's where I started my schooling and my football career. Mm-hmm. I was in Kumasi because I spent a lot of time playing as a player for 11 to 12 years. Mm-hmm. And then as a coach for 4 years. And that's where I started my coaching career. So that's the reason why I did in Kumasi. Now Accra is the seat of the government, and for that reason, you can't run away from it. And you see, that's not the end. We are planning to visit all the regional capitals, you know, after the Accra launch.
Okay, so where will I get a copy of this book? I have mine, but those who are watching us need to know where they are buying theirs.
Yeah, you can get it if you want to call on phone. It's a number 054-360-6080.
Okay.
You know, the number again.
Mm-hmm. Don't worry. Go on.
054-360-6080.
Okay.
And it will be on Amazon.
Okay.
So it will be easy to get it from the net. And then Kingdom Bishop, hopefully by next week you should get the whole stock. And there are some other areas that we will be putting there. Later, I think organizers will let everyone know about
where else to get it.
Yeah.
All right, then. It's been a great pleasure, Coach James Kwesi Appiah. And he didn't yell.
No, actually, you don't have to.
So it's been an interesting conversation on Face to Face with him, discussing his new book, Leaders Don't Have to Yell, National Team Coach on Leading High Performing Teams. It's a book on leadership. It's a book that recounts some of his best and his worst experiences. I hope you've enjoyed this chat with him on Face to Face today. My name is Godfred Akoto Boafo. See you on the next episode.